Thanks a lot. It's a real pleasure to be here. My aim today is really just to tell you a nice story. I mean, I'm a mathematician, and unfortunately, even though I've been working with physicists for some years now, my knowledge of physics is limited. So, I mean, please forgive me if I cannot answer properly some of your questions, but I will try my best. Also, the type of things I'm going to tell you is probably totally orthogonal to the things you have been working in or you work in. But anyhow, probably it's a nice story to tell. And probably you are interested on the type of questions that emerge from the talk. So please feel free to interrupt me at any time with your questions. So it's a nice story. And the story begins here in Paris, 1900. At ICM, so the International Congress of Mathematicians, this guy, David Hilbert, gave a conference in which he proposed 23 problems in mathematics for the century, meaning for the past century now. They kind of guided mathematics for many years. And among one of those problems was especially important, which is problem number two, the compatibility of the arithmetical axioms. So this was at that time the idea that mathematics should be a consistent and complete theory, in the sense that, one could prove the consistency of the axioms, and one could essentially prove anything from the axioms. And it was kind of the idea was to make this formal. It came as a shock when in 31, Carl Goedel, working on these type of questions, proved the so-called incompleteness theorems. And in particular, one of those said that there exist statements that cannot be proven or disproven from the action of mathematics. And there are many, many now concrete ones that are known to be the case, and one can impose them as axioms if one wants, that are independent. In a very related direction, Alan Turing, kind of 5 years later, did something similar, but instead of theorems, with algorithms. In the end, a theorem is like an algorithm. It's a way to go from the axioms to the final proof. No? He introduced or formalized what an algorithm is and realized that there exist problems or families of problems for which no algorithm exists, no matter how inefficient. It was not a problem of finding a fast algorithm. It was a problem that an algorithm cannot even written down. It's just impossible to write. Both results have really been behind mathematics and computer science as really something that small mystery, let's say. By the way, one of such problems was the halting problem, which is a very natural problem if an algorithm will stop or not at some point. It's also known, it's somehow easy to see that this is somehow stronger than this. So whenever one gets undecidability in the sense of Turing, let's say that no algorithm can exist for a family of problems, then immediately one instance of that problem must be independent of the action of mathematics. So somehow that's the idea. So this is stronger than this. So this is why came later. So in the sense, all these results, as I say, shook mathematics. But of course, mathematics is the language to model physics. So there should be an implication in physics of these things. So which are those implications? And of course, I'm not the first, of course, in history to ask this question. And this, many people, explore this path, mainly in the 80s and 90s. I put here some names. But all the problems, some of physically motivated problems they proposed to be undecidable, were somehow contrived, artificial. Indeed, somehow, Charlie Bennett, in a kind of comment article about one of those papers, started like that. So that saying that there has been surprisingly few applications of these ideas, meaning ideas of Turing and Gödel, to physics. In particular, the phenomenon of undecidability has not asserted itself in a simple, uncontrived physical setting, the way that, for instance, deterministic chaos as a far weaker property has. And somehow this was the idea that there should be some undecidable problem that was somehow natural, but it was not easy to see where, how to find it. Which other problems could one explore in order to get other undecidable problems in physics. And okay, in order to do that, one can go back again to Hilbert and Paris and 1900, and another of these 23 problems, which is the sixth problem. And the sixth problem is the mathematical treatment of the axioms of physics. So Hilbert was also saying, okay, if mathematics is the model of physics, we want to make mathematics rigorous, consistent, complete. One can try to do the same with the physics part, no? With the physics that is modeled by mathematics. And in particular, he claimed or focused on the theory of probability and in mechanics. Of course, classical mechanics, at that time quantum mechanics didn't exist. No? And in particular, I mean, he said the type of problems he would look at as the most important ones. And it's somehow the limiting process between the atomic level and the macroscopic law of motions of the continuum. That's kind of the, and he specified as an important question to do that concretely for Boltzmann's work on the principle of mechanics, where he suggested this, I mean, to make this mathematically rigorous. Okay, so the idea then is, okay, maybe going from the microscopic interaction to some macroscopic property, doing this in this path, something could be undecidable. It'd be a nice way to mix somehow the second and the sixth problem of Hilbert. And indeed, already in 72, Anderson, in his paper in Science More is Different, postulated that there could be an issue with some implication. There could be that it's not that easy to go from microscopy to macroscopy. There could be even different levels in which one should look at physics. No? So, okay, so why not to look at these type of problems? And what is a good setup for that? So a good setup for that is quantum spin systems in the thermodynamic limit. Why? Because, of course, it's a setup in which we analyze microscopic interactions, and we want to see what happens in the limit where the number of particles goes to infinity, which and understands a macroscopic property like the decay of correlations or, I mean, topological order or whatever property we are interested in there. Okay, there are other systems, other possibilities to go from this micro to macroscopic, but okay, this is the one we look at because it's the one we were working in, of course. So let me specify a bit the setup. So the setup is just a 2D lattice, let's assume a square lattice, n times n, and in each vertex of the lattice, we have a d-dimensional Hilbert space associated to each side. We can understand it as a spin if you want, okay? Any quantum system with d degrees of freedom. And we will assume that we have nearest neighbor interactions between the kind of the particles, and that are translational invariant. So somehow the way one particle interacts with the next one is independent of the position of the particles in the lattice. Okay? In this way, okay, and this nearest neighbor interaction is h, small h. So if I sum all these interactions depending on the position I, so hi is just the same interaction h but on position I, so I get the Hamiltonian of the system. And the Hamiltonian, of course, depends on the number of particles. But a single interaction term defines the Hamiltonian for all possible number of particles. Okay? So we have the microscopic description of the interaction, which is small h. And we have the macroscopic properties, which are the properties of the system when n goes to infinity, when the number of particles goes to infinity. Okay? This is one way to go to macroscopic. There are other ways to go to macroscopic, which is, for instance, taking the spacing to zero. But okay, let's concentrate on taking the number going to infinity. Okay. Okay, which properties we want to analyze? Properties, I mean, that one is interested in, and the two we will analyze are the decay of correlations and the spectral gap. Oh, sorry, spectral gap. And the spectral gap is nothing but the difference between the two smallest energy levels in the Hamiltonian. Okay. Lambda zero is the ground energy, and lambda one, the energy of the first excited state. And this is just the gap in energy between the two smallest levels. Of course, this depends on n, on the number of particles. Okay? And then the question is, how does this quantity behave as n goes to infinity, as the number of particles grow? And we would like to know if the system has a gap or not. And this means that such quantities are bounded by below, from below, by a constant that does not depend on the system size n. Okay, so all these gaps are uniformly bounded by a constant, C, that is universal, doesn't depend on the system size. Okay, in size K, we say the system has a gap. Okay, why to look at this quantity? Okay, our motivation comes from ConMat, where the spectral gap in quantum spin systems, or strongly correlated systems, defines the concept of quantum phase, phase transition, phase diagram, etc. No, for instance, in this very diagrammatic picture, in which I have here a ferromagnetic phase and antiferromagnetic phase. In this phase, the gap is, I can connect any two points in this phase, keeping the gap open. And the same in this phase, but if I want to cross in this phase transition line, the gap must close, okay, in order to make the transition. And this is the way one can formalize the notion of a phase and phase diagram of phase transition in the quantum case, just looking at the spectral gap. And this is why the spectral gap is important, okay, and this is why we look at it. Okay, the spectral gap is important also besides math physics, and also is important in quantum information and computation, because, for instance, in adiabatic quantum computation, in which one prepares a Hamiltonian and the ground state, and this is a Hamiltonian one can do, and one can prepare, one can cool it to prepare the ground state, and one changes the parameter slowly to a target Hamiltonian, and one wants to know that the ground state keeps in the ground state until the end, and then you kind of, the final ground state encodes the output of your computation. The speed at which one is able to tune or to change the parameters depend on the spectral gap of the Hamiltonians under consideration. And again, this is the quantity one looks at in order to see how efficient the quantum algorithm is in this adiabatic quantum computing. Okay. So this is why we concentrated on this quantity. And okay, what we proved is that this quantity is undecidable. So, not the quantity, the fact that a system is gapped or not. So, even if one has a perfect description of the microscopic interaction, it's impossible to predict if the macroscopic system will have a gap or not. Okay? So, informally, I will state the result formally in a second, but informally, we have the following problem. The input is a nearest neighbor interaction H. Okay? And the output is to decide if the Hamiltonian big H constructed from small h has a gap or not in the thermodynamic limit when the number of particles goes to infinity. And the theorem is that this problem is undecidable. So there is no algorithm that on input h decides it. Okay? And again, I emphasize that it's not a problem of finding an efficient algorithm. There is no algorithm, no matter how inefficient. One cannot even write the algorithm down. Okay? That's the idea. And in particular, there are nearest neighbor interactions, some of those, for which the existence of a gap or not is independent of the actions of mathematics. Okay, one cannot prove or disprove the gap with mathematics. Okay, that's the. So the result is even stronger than that, because we can even prove it with a big promise. So even if we give the promise that in the gap case, the gap is as large as one can expect, so the large is larger than the strength of the interaction, than the norm of H. Okay, for all system sizes, and the ground state and fresh excited states are, okay, the ground state is unique and product, and the fresh excited states are also product. Okay. So in the gap is as gap as one would like. Okay, unique ground state, product ground state, so no quantum, purely classical if you want. A gap as large as the interaction strength, nothing, so it's kind of a very, very well behaved system. And in the gapless case, the system is as gapless as one, as it could be. So the spectrum becomes totally dense on the real line or on the positive real line, as you prefer. So even then, I give you a nearest neighbor interaction, and I promise you that one of the two things happens. So, or it's very, very gap, or it's very, very gapless. And it tells you, okay, tell me which one of the two. Write me an algorithm that decides which one of the two. Still, you cannot do that, okay? Even with this big promise. Okay, so that's the statement, and a similar statement happens for many other kind of macroscopic properties, for instance, decay of correlations. So problem now is, again, the input is the nearest neighbor interaction, and the output is decide if the ground state of the big Hamiltonian has power law decaying correlations or exponentially decaying correlations. And again, this is undecidable. Same argument, same kind of meaning as before. Good? Okay. So I would like to go a bit more formal to really make the exact statement we do and what do we mean by undecidable. But for that, I have to just talk very briefly about Turing machines, which is kind of the way to formalize undecidability, because it's the way to formalize what an algorithm is. Probably you already know that, but I mean, just in case there are people with different backgrounds, I will just go through it. So what is a Turing machine? Okay, a Turing machine is just, is kind of, again, is the model of an algorithm of what, how a computer works. So we have an infinite tape, so we don't want to get out of memory, so we assume that we have an infinite tape. And we have a binary alphabet that we can write on the tape, so zeros and ones. The machine has a number, a finite number of internal states of memory. And among those states, there is one particular state, which is the halting state. There is also a head that tells which position in the tape the machine is looking at. Okay? There is an initial cell that I mark in red, an initial configuration, which is initially written down in the tape. Most of the cases is just all zeros. Which is the internal state of the machine at the beginning, which is usually A. And this is the initial configuration. And now we need a set of instructions. The set of instructions tell us what to do if the head is in this position, reading an element of the alphabet and in some internal state. So if I'm in an internal state of the set Q and I'm reading an element of the alphabet S, the instructions tell me what to write here, what element to write here, what state to transition to, which is this, and if the head should move left or right. Okay? And this specifies totally the algorithm. So let me just, sorry, do one example. So imagine that we start in this initial configuration. So we are looking at zero and we are in internal state A. So we go to the set of instructions and we have to look for what to do in that case. Okay, and imagine as an example that the instruction is C1 right. Okay, I switch the podcast clear. So this means that I should write a one, the internal state should be C, and I should move the head to the right. Okay, what I do here. So at time one, the configuration of the machine is this one. Now I'm reading a zero, I'm in internal state C, so I should go to my set of instructions and look what to do, and then imagine that's B1 left, so I write a one, I transition to B, and I move the head to the left. So the time two configuration is this one. And I keep going until the machine enters into the halting state. And in this moment, the computation stops, and what is written in the tape is the output of the computation. Okay, that's how it is. Good. So, okay, before I forgot. So look at how many Turing machines are there. Okay, for a fixed number of internal states, there are just finitely many. Because if I fix the number of internal states, everything is totally given, and all I can decide is the number of instructions. But the number of instructions is functions between finite sets. So there are finitely many possibilities. Okay? So for a fixed number of internal states, there are finitely many Turing machines. Since I allow this to be any natural number, there are countably many Turing machines. So there is a mapping between Turing machines and natural numbers. Okay? And there are explicit mappings. And okay, choose your favorite one. And I will identify sometimes a Turing machine with a natural number. Okay, which is somehow is a way to simply give enumerate the Turing machines. Okay, and when I talk about the Turing machine N, is the Turing machine who has associated the natural number N. Good. Okay, so as I said, a very important problem is if the Turing machine will halt or not, because if it does not halt, the computation never ends, and okay, there is no computation. So there is no output of the computation. So this is the halting problem. And okay, we say that the Turing machine halts on input n. If I fit n in binary at the right of the red cell, and okay, this is n in binary, so I write it reverse wise. If it eventually enters the halting state, okay, if at some point the machine halts, no matter how long it takes, but it halts. And we say that the Turing machine halts without specifying the input if it halts on input 0. And the halting problem is, given a Turing machine, does it halt or not? And Turing proved that this problem is undecidable, in the sense that there is no algorithm, that is, there is no Turing machine, that on input another Turing machine, meaning the natural number associated to that Turing machine, decides whether the input Turing machine halts or not, meaning that the Turing machine that is checking that halts and outputs 0, if the input Turing machine holds, and one if it doesn't. Okay? So such Turing machine doesn't exist. And this implies that the halting problem is undecidable. There cannot exist any algorithm that, given as input the description of another algorithm, always stops at some point and decides what happened to that algorithm, to the halting property of that algorithm. Okay, in the very same paper, Turing also talked about universal Turing machines. A universal Turing machine is a Turing machine that can simulate any other Turing machine, in the following sense, that somehow the universal Turing machine on input n behaves as the Turing machine indexed by n on input 0. That's the why it's called universal. And these universal Turing machines are totally explicit. You can find them in Wikipedia, so it's not something very mysterious. I mean, they are there. Okay, you can give them explicitly. And therefore, as a corollary, we obtain that, okay, we Turing obtain that there is no algorithm that on input a natural number n decides whether the universal Turing machine holds or not on input n. Okay? So take your favorite universal Turing machine. Again, this is totally explicit. You can find them in Wikipedia. And then the question is, okay, I fit this Turing machine with a natural number n, and I ask whether this machine will hold or not. Okay, this is undecidable. So what we will do is to reduce the gap of Hamiltonian problem to this problem. Okay, so we will find Hamiltonians, families of Hamiltonians indexed by the natural numbers, that the existence or absence of gap is related to the behavior of the universal Turing machine in a natural number. And that's the construction we do. Okay? And therefore, the gap is undecidable. Before that, as I said before, there is a connection between undecidability a la Turing and Goedel independence. Okay? This is, if you want, the formal way to see that one implies the other. But I mean, the important thing is that whenever something is Turing undecidable, at least one instance of the problem is Goedel independent from the axiom of mathematics. Okay? So we will, I will, in the next slide, state formally our undecidability result a la Turing, but there is immediately a corollary about independence of the axioms of mathematics. Good. Okay, so which is our result in a formal, the formal statement of the result? Okay, so we need, okay, this is our setup, so we have n times n lattice, big N, and now a small n will be a natural number. Okay, natural. So for each natural number, small n, I give three interactions. One is a row interaction, so it's the interaction of how one particle interacts with the next to it, so let's say to the next neighbor, in the same row. I give a column interaction in which I see, I describe how one particle interacts with the next to it in the same column. And I also have kind of a local interaction, H1, that is just single site interaction. The three of them, in principle, depends on n. And then I consider the Hamiltonian associated to these three interactions by translational invariance. So I simply sum on all possible rows, the sum in all possible positions in the row of this H row located in the corresponding position. So it's translational invariant. It's the same H everywhere, but located in different positions. The same with the columns and the same with the single sides. Okay? So the system is translational invariant. It's not in general rotational invariant, but it's translational invariant. Okay? So these three interactions, given for every natural number I give the three of them, define this Hamiltonian for all system size big N and for each natural number small n. So these have the following properties. Okay, I will specify now more things here, but let's go first to the end. So all terms have operator norm bounded by one. So the strength of the interaction is all of them bounded by one. So I'm not giving infinite energies or anything like that here. Okay? And now we see the difference. So if the universal Turing machine holds on input n, then for all system sizes big n, the spectrum of h contains the zero, and the next eigenstate is larger than one. So the next eigenvalue is larger than one, sorry. So the gap is at least one. And moreover, the multiplicity of the eigenvalue zero is one. So there is a unique eigenvalue. There is no degeneracy. So the gap is larger than one, and the ground state is unique for all system sizes. But if the universal Turing machine does not hold on input n, then the spectrum becomes dense in the real line. Okay? So there's no gap in the whole spectrum. And since it was proven by Turing that deciding the behavior of the halting behavior of the universal Turing machine on an input n is undecidable, the same is true for this. Okay, that's the result. So now, okay, which now, I mean, the thing is a bit stronger in the sense that the dependency on the natural number n is quite mild. So we fix a natural number n, and we consider the rational number, which is just the same natural number, but when we put the binary digits, I mean, at the other side of the comma, no? I mean, just the corresponding rational number, let's say, with the same digits. And now the Hamiltonian will be of the following form. So the column part will be independent of n, is some Hermitian matrix A. The row part will be B plus beta, also with this beta, C, D, and P, all these things are independent of n. So the only dependency on n is in some coupling coefficient. So in this e to the I pi phi, phi is this, in this e to the I pi 2 to the minus the number of bits of phi, and in this alpha n. So just three coupling coefficients plus Hermitian conjugates is the only dependency on n. The other terms, so the terms of the Hamiltonian are universal, are the same for all natural numbers. And moreover, we give them explicitly. So we give explicitly a dimension D, and we give explicit matrices A, B, C, D, and P, and a rational number beta, as small as desired, so that this happens.
Actually, I did not understand the definition of coupling constants. I don't know, is it important?
What?
I did not understand.
What this E to the I pi phi is?
Yeah, it's hard to see what's
it. Sorry, yes. So, let me just.
If this is important, if it's not important.
No, of course, it's just that the dependent, of course, in principle, the dependency on n, all the entries of the matrix C could depend on n in arbitrary ways, in principle. All I'm claiming is that C is fixed, doesn't depend on n, and the dependency on this matrix on n is just because C is multiplied by some complex number that depends on n. Okay, simply that. So the dependency on all entries of C of n is the same because they are multiplied by the same object. Okay, it's a very mild dependency. Okay, how the coupling coefficient depends on n is not that important. Okay, it's just e to the I pi phi, but it's simply that it depends via a coupling coefficient with a particular form. Okay, that's all that matters.
What's important to say is that it's only a phase.
Okay, because we can guarantee that is the case, but of course if you put something more general, it's also true, but we can guarantee that is the case. We are trying to give an undecidable result with the least possible complexity, in a sense, okay? And there is another very nice thing. So the dependency on n, as I told, is kind of very mild, but also consider just A and B. A and B are just classical Hamiltonians. Okay? Classical meaning that they are diagonal in the computational basis. And now beta is as small as desired. And alpha is also smaller than beta. So all the part of the Hamiltonian in which there is a dependency on n are multiplied, so have a norm which is smaller than beta, and beta is as small as desired. So this Hamiltonian is just an arbitrary small quantum perturbation of a classical Hamiltonian, which is the Hamiltonian AP. Okay? Okay? And even with all that, we have this undecidable result. So we have a classical Hamiltonian, we perturb it arbitrarily small in some directions, quantumly, of course, and depending on which direction or which strength in that direction, we go from totally gap to totally gapless in an unpredictable way, really unpredictable in the most strongest sense. Okay, that's the.
By classical, you mean that before the perturbation, the ground state is a product state.
You have a lot of degeneracies. Classical means that these A and B are diagonal in the computational basis of the Hilbert space.
C and D are not diagonal.
Sorry.
On C and D are not diagonal on that basis.
They are diagonal on CD. Yeah. Yes.
C and D too.
Yes. They are diagonal here. Yes. So they are in CD tensor CD, they are diagonal here, yes.
No, he's saying the operator C and D.
No, CD are not. No, they are. No, of course, yeah. No, of course. The other part is totally quantum. So, no, it's a quantum perturbation of a classical system. No. The part within beta is quantum, is pure quantum. Yeah, sure. Of course. No. Indeed, this result is for a fixed dimension D is impossible in classical. So you need something quantum there. Okay? No. But by classical I mean diagonal in the computational basis here. Okay, this is what I mean. Good. Okay, so this is the formal statement. So any question so far or any other further question? Yes, sure.
Are you going to explain how you map this?
Okay, if I have time, I have some backup slides about the ideas of the proof. And if you are interested, I can just go fast in the rest and go there. I mean, yes, definitely, yeah, I can do that, definitely. I mean, the proof is very technical, but the ideas are not that difficult in the end. So. Okay, I can tell you now. let's go then to the end of the talk. No, I mean, it's no problem. It's probably the most interesting part. So I will blah, blah. Thank you for your attention. Okay, and then, good. So, ingredients of the proof. So, first of all, the proof is really technical. So, I mean, the full mathematical proof is 140 something pages. So, it's really technical. Okay, but there are just four ideas. And the first idea is to write N on the tape. So, we want to go from Turing machines to Hamiltonians. No? So, okay, we start with a Turing machine, and we want that this Turing machine writes a natural number N on the tape. Okay, if we want to do this with a classical Turing machine, the size of the machine, meaning the number of internal states, must be large. Because, as I said, if for a fixed number of internal states, there is a finite number of Turing machines. So I cannot write all natural numbers with a finite number of Turing machines. This cannot be. No? So if I want to write N on the tape, or I grow the number of internal states of the machine, or I go quantum. Okay? Then I decided to go quantum. So, and then the first ingredient is to prove or to construct a quantum Turing machine, which, okay, is the analog of a classical Turing machine for quantum computation, with size independent of N. Let's say size is the number of internal states. And it's crucial that the size of the machine does not depend on N. And this is where the quantumness enters in this. So that for each N larger than N, on input many, many, many ones, outputs always N in binary. That's the key. And it has very nice space and time requirements that we require in the proof. And the idea is that this quantum Turing machine is nothing but the machine associated to the quantum phase estimation algorithm, okay? Which is kind of the algorithm behind most of the quantum algorithms, anyhow. Okay? So this is the first. So prove that for a quantum Turing machine, one can write N on a tape without growing the size of the machine. This, of course, classically is totally impossible, because this is true for any natural number. This is the first ingredient. The second ingredient, of course, is now to go from Turing machines, quantum Turing machines, to quantum Hamiltonians. And the idea is that for a classical or quantum Turing machine, there is a 1D nearest neighbor interaction, so that the ground state is unique and is the equal weight superposition of the evolution of the machine on an input. Okay. So, and that now if I initialize the machine and I run it, and it halts at some point, then I can penalize with energy the halting state, and then I gain different, I get different energies in the ground state of the Hamiltonian, depending on whether the machine halts or not. So by constructing exactly a Hamiltonian for which the ground state is the superposition of the evolution of the Turing machine, and by penalizing the halting state, one gets a difference in the ground state energy, which is exponentially small in N. But there is a difference already. So in this ingredient, we go from Turing machines to Hamiltonians, whose spectrum, ground state energy, depends on the behavior of the machine. Depends exponentially small, but depends. Okay? And okay, this is the idea that goes back to Feynman and Kitaev of kind of this way to encode evolution in a evolution. I mean, this what is called computational history states. These things are called. But here we exploit the recent constructions of Gottesman and Irani. We have to build on them. Okay, so that's the second part. The third part is to amplify this spectral difference from exponentially small to very large. And it's here where we have to go to two dimensions. So far, everything is 1D. And for that, we exploit the existence of aperiodic tilings. In particular, this is Robinson tiling. So these tiles, together with rotations and reflections, so they generate this pattern. And this pattern is many small squares of one size, many squares of larger size, many squares of larger size, and so on and so forth. So you have infinitely many squares of all sizes, which are powers of 4. Okay, and for that you only need finally many tiles, so you can encode this pattern in the ground state of a nearest neighbor interaction, in which the interaction somehow penalizes putting the tiles together in a right or a not right place. And in this case, you have to put tiles. You can put two tiles together if the arrows continues each other. So if the arrow head here continues to the arrow tail here, and the same with this one. And you cannot put it if somehow the arrows are broken. Okay? And by kind of identifying colors with this pattern, you get this. And now what you do is you somehow do the construction, the 1D construction of the previous ingredient in the upper border of each one of the squares of all possible sizes. And then you start to gain a lot of difference in energies. I mean, these things that was exponentially small before, I mean, amplifies. And it amplifies really a lot, in the sense that after this ingredient, we have a nearest neighbor interaction in 2D, so that in a square region of size L, we have a difference of energy of order L square, depending on whether the universal Turing machine on input N holds or not. Okay? Okay, this L square is multiplied by something which is uncomputably small or whatever, it doesn't matter, L square. And now by adding a term multiple of the identity, we shift energies, and then we are in this position. So if the Turing machine does not hold, this is somehow the spectrum, so the ground state has energy that goes to minus infinity, and if it holds, the ground state energy that has energy that goes to plus infinity. And now we take other two Hamiltonians, one critical one and a trivial one, and we manage to place the critical on top of the ground energy, and to just place the spectrum of H0, just shift it here, so in this direction, this way. And we see, if it holds, there is a gap. If it doesn't hold, it's gapless. And that's the end of the construction. OK, that's the idea. Good. OK, so these are the ingredients of the proof. So if you want more, I can tell you more later. But that's the 4 ingredients, OK? So let me go back now to the presentation. Blah, 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 blah. Let's see. Good. Okay, here. Okay, good. More questions or? Sure.
Is there a relation to the gap and the existence of the limit?
It's a very good question. It could be, but in our case, this is not an issue. So in our case, in both the halting and in the not halting case, the thermodynamic limit is well defined. It's simply that you don't know which one of the two it is. But it's not a problem that is not well defined. Okay? It's not a problem that is well defined in both cases, but it's impossible to know which one of the two is the one that will happen. Yes?
In practice, this means that the limit kicks in at a time that can be extremely large and you don't know.
Exactly. I will exactly say this now in the next slide. Exactly. That's the thing. So, which are the implications of this, let's say, for things more kind of practical, concrete? And it's exactly the existence of this size-driven quantum phase transition. So somehow you have some physics at some scale, and at some point this may totally switch to different physics, but this can be as large as you want, so you will never realize that. Okay, and this we call this, so let me formalize this idea, it's exactly the same. So what this is a name that we invented, okay? Size-driven quantum phase transition can be a very bad name. I take off the blame for that, okay? But it's simply this is the idea, okay? The low energy sector has radically different properties for sizes smaller than a threshold n critical and for sizes larger than n critical. In the sense, for instance, that for all sizes smaller than n critical, the system or the low energy sector is totally classical. For instance, unique product ground state and product first excited states and a constant spectral gap all the way. But from some moment on, the system becomes very quantum. For instance, topological order with topological degeneracy, anionic excitations, or whatever. Okay? And this n-critical, in principle, can be very large. Okay? So imagine that this n-critical is very large, much larger than one is able to simulate in a numerics experiment, for instance. Then if you do numerics, what you see is that you have a unique product ground state, so zero correlation length, a constant spectral gap, so it seems that nothing is going to happen. But at some point, maybe beyond your numeric capabilities, the physics totally change. And you are somehow missing that. Okay? So, okay, can they exist? Yes, because this is just a corollary of this undecidability. So There exist systems with size-driven phase transitions for arbitrary large, even uncomputable critical size. Uncritical. So there are systems for what this uncritical can be as large as you want, and you cannot predict, because it's undecidable, if this uncritical will appear or not at some point. Okay? Sorry?
How about the other direction? We don't want it to be too large, because if it's larger than the size of the universe, then it would be in trouble.
Totally right. But somehow this it's a very good question. This poses the question of how to define now properly the thermodynamic limit. So of course, there is a mathematical thermodynamic limit, which is n going to infinity. But if this n critical is 10 to the 30,000, I mean, you will never find it. No? It's a very nice question. So the thing is that the examples that we have so far are quite involved, because are these constructions of undecidability. And the local dimension, this d, even if it's fixed and explicit, is very, very large. So these still are mathematical objects, purely mathematical objects. So the question, of course, is, okay, are there easier examples of these size-driven transitions with a small local dimension, let's say in which this d is mild, let's say 5, 6, 10, something like that. And okay, for that we have a second construction, using some of the ideas, of course, of the previous construction, like tilings. And let me just go very briefly through it. So the idea is that I still have time. So it's based on what are called Wang tiles. This Robinson tile I told you before is a particular type of Wang tile. A Wang tile is just a set of tiles, square tiles, in which I color the edges. Okay, for instance, this edge is green, this red, this blue, this green. And then I have a number of colors and a set of tiles with color edges. And then I have a rule that I can put two tiles together only if the colors of the common edge coincide. So this is okay and this is not okay. And then the question is, the tiling problem. Can I tile the plane? So if I give you this set of tiles, can you tile the plane? And this problem is undecidable. Okay, it was proven by Berger that this is undecidable. And the key idea why this is undecidable is because there are one tiles that produce aperiodic tilings of the plane, as the one of Robinson that you used before. And okay, in concrete, this one produces an aperiodic tiling of the plane, which is this one. Okay, so this is one example. Okay, so now it's very easy, if I have a set of tiles, to construct a Hamiltonian. So I associate to each tile a basis element in the Hilbert space. So the set of tiles is the basis, and the number of tiles is the Hilbert dimension. And I simply penalize if I put two tiles which are incompatible next to each other. So okay, I have a row interaction that gives energies to pairs of tiles that are not allowed to be put together. And vertically, I do the same. And then I do the Hamiltonian, which is the translational invariant version of all this. And it's clear that this Hamiltonian just simply count how many tiles are put in a wrong position. So the energy is zero in a region if and only if this region is tileable, and is larger if it's not. And the ground state, in the case energy is zero, is a valid tiling. Okay, of course, there can be degeneracies in principle, anything. And okay, this is classical, it's diagonal in the computational basis, it's obvious. Okay, so then the first observation is, okay, imagine that I have a set of tiles that can tile a region of size, let's say, n critical to n critical, but not a region larger than that. Then it's clear that they have a change in the ground state energy from zero to at least one. And I can exploit this change to make a switch between two different phases. Okay, and this is the idea. So the problem, the mathematical problem, is now how to get the largest possible n critical with the smallest possible number of tiles. Okay, because we want very mild dimension to get very large critical sizes. Okay, that's the idea. Okay, so a nice mathematical problem that is not totally solved. And then we simply found good solutions to it. And this is the table of our numbers. So these are the dimensions of the local Hilbert space from 5 to 10. And this is the largest critical size we were able to get with this dimension. And then you, for instance, realize that already with dimension 10, you can get systems that are totally classical, I mean, at least in the low energy sector, up to sizes 10 to the 30,000 times 10 to the 30,000, because it's a square lattice. And in this moment, they become topologically ordered. And this is exactly this question, of course. This is beyond everything, no? So, but still, this happens, okay? Of course, you can get this at essentially any order of magnitude, let's say, okay, these are. So you can also get this effect for things that are about the current capabilities, numerical or experimental or whatever. No, that's the idea. And we have two mathematical tools for that. One is we call long period tilings. That is the best for between 5 and 8. And then Turing machine tilings, which is the best from 9 to on. Okay, so in the, for, I will give brief the ideas of this Turing machine tiling. Essentially what you do is you are able to map a tiling problem into a Turing machine problem. This is exactly what Berger did somehow to prove undecidability, but in a smarter way, in order to keep the best possible control on this dimension. And the idea is just we define a tile set so that there is a unique valid tiling, which is the evolution of the Turing machine if I encode space in diagonal and time in vertical. So let's say this is the configuration, if diagonal like that is the configuration of the machine in a time slice. So this is time one, time two, time three, blah, 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 so on and so forth. And now if we remove the tiles that transition into the halting state, then n critical is exactly the halting time. And because the halting time is undecidable, the dependency on the number of tiles with respect to n critical is large, is faster than any computable function. So this grows faster than the exponential of the exponential of the exponential of the exponential of the dimension. And this is why one can get these huge numbers with very small dimension. And in particular, we exploit a Turing machine with a small number of internal states and with large halting time, which is this innocent looking Turing machine. So I give you this Turing machine. This is the alphabet 01, and this is the number of internal states, and this is the set of instructions. What to do if I am reading a 0 and I am in internal state B? Okay, I should do 1, write C. Okay? And H is halting. So if you initialize the machine in 0, will it halt? And when it will halt? Okay, so it has been proven recently, 7 years ago, that this halts, but after more than 10 to the 30,000 steps. Okay, so this is what shows that this n critical can grow much, 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 much faster than this dimension and get this kind of table of examples here. Okay, so I'm thinking close to end of my time. So let me just summarize that we have now mathematically simple systems with size-driven phase transitions. Okay. Simple meaning a small dimension. But of course, it's interesting. Can one find them in nature? At least can one engineer them in a lab? So we have at least identified three ingredients which are crucial in our construction. Okay, it's not obvious to see them in what I told you, but okay, they are crucial. One is to have these long periods which are tunable. Okay, this more or less one understands from what I said to you. We need a direct sum extraction in each local Hilbert space that one can exploit. This is also important. And of course, we need to have topological order in order to, after the transition, obtain topological order in the system. So we need somehow a type of systems that allow these three ingredients, at least independently, and then we have to mix them together. So I was giving a talk about exactly this result, kind of, okay, not exactly this, but okay, this circle of ideas, like 1 year ago, and then Benoit Dussault, who's here in Paris, was in the audience, and then he came to me and said, I think I know how to have these three ingredients independently in superconducting circuits. Okay, I had no idea what a superconducting circuit was at that time. But we have been discussing together for somehow like 1 year now, and with work in progress, but it seems that it's very promising, that I'm very confident that we can really produce an experiment that one can do with superconducting circuits in which one observes this type of size-driven phase transition for reasonable sizes. I mean, I don't know, hundreds of thousands of small pieces of the circuit, something like that. But okay, this, since I'm a mathematician, I'm still very, very kind of far from understanding exactly all the physics of the problem, but okay, let's say that we are confident that we will get this soon. So let me summarize this nice story, what I find a nice story, because it starts with the most abstract part of mathematics, let's say, Goedel and Undecidability, the consistency of mathematics. Then it shows that this has an impact in physics. So some quantity of interest in CONMAT, like a spectral gap, is undecidable. Then this predicts the existence of systems which are somehow weird, these size-driven phase transition systems. Then we develop an intuition of which are the key ingredients for these transitions to happen. This intuition may help identifying real systems. By real, I mean that can be engineered with size-driven phase transition, which is work in progress. And of course, maybe, who knows, these are things are even useful for something at some point. Okay, something, who knows. And okay, with this, I finish. Thank you.
What will happen if there is a Turing machine, there is a tiling, or there is a Hamiltonian for which you can mathematically prove that the spectral gap is undecidable, but then experimentally you do the experiment and you see that there is no gap?
It's a very good question. The thing, of course, is that you can only do experiments, I guess, for a finite size. And then, because the undecidability nature of these things, you will never know, and it is, you cannot know, what will happen if you do the same experiment with a large number of particles. So it's very difficult, at least I don't see a way to conclude from an experiment this property, which is a property that mathematically is defined as a limit of things. No? So it's, in the end, I think it's a problem about the mathematical modeling of the problem, because I mean, in order to mathematically talk rigorously about phase transitions and phases and the key of correlations, you need to take the thermodynamic limit. But it's about the model of the problem. It's not about the physics of the problem. No? And then it's very difficult for me, I don't know, I mean, but it's very difficult for me to imagine a way in which one can experimentally test these things, really, in the sense of you comment. But I must confess, I didn't think much on that question, so I don't know.
Do you know if you have an Hamiltonian that, you know, it's undecidable, it will be isolated or it will be one of many?
It's a very good question. The undecidable Hamiltonians we have, they are totally fine-tuned in the sense that they are, they must be those there. And we do not have any, of course, there cannot be a nice stability structure result, because somehow what we show is that there exist examples in which this cannot happen. Our models are models which are totally chaotically unstable. By changing this arbitrary small in one direction, you change totally the physics. So, but what we do have is an analysis of the stability in the case of size-driven transition. So in this mathematical paper we have, I showed you here, in which we have this table, we also analyze the robustness of the construction with respect to, in concrete, to thermal noise. And it's very, very robust with respect to thermal noise. So the temperatures you need to observe exactly the same critical transitions are very, very mild, even for this. So okay. The problem here is not temperature, it's the size. But for the undecidability, unfortunately, we don't know.
Can one find conditions on families of Hamiltonian that ensure the monotonicity of the gap with the size, which seems the most natural, I mean,
it's
the most
It's an extremely nice question, and we are working on it. Indeed, the approach we are following now is to try to show that if you add a very small amount of disorder, all these undecidable problems vanish in expectation, something like that. But unfortunately, we do not have any results yet. But it's an extremely interesting question, of course, which are the natural conditions to impose so that you can be sure that you are happy with finite size analysis and then nothing strange will happen. It's an extremely nice question. Unfortunately, I don't have much to say now apart from that.
I have a question that follows up from Slava. Instead of giving it to an experimentalist, give it to a theoretical physicist. He could do maybe mean field approach or maybe Monte Carlo approach. Both approaches are probably outside the scope of your Hamiltonian or Turing machine because there are some stochasticity. Do you, I mean, they could decide that maybe this problem has some gap or not. Have you tried to give it to some?
I mean, it cannot be, no, because they are algorithms. So we prove that there cannot be any algorithm at all that works.
Even stochastic algorithm?
No, even stochastic, yes. So the.
If you consider the appropriately normalized density of levels. So
again, it's a very nice question. It's a very nice question. In the size-driven transition, we can work with the Gibbs state directly. and then okay, we have really a finite temperature, and we have the density of all eigenstates, and again, you can essentially observe the same critical transitions with very mild temperatures. In the undecidable case, we have no clue, unfortunately. It's a very nice question, again, is to make this more physical, but so far, it's a very hard question. We don't know.
But I didn't understand what is the nature of this phase transition. Okay, the gap goes to zero, but what is the ground state? Is it periodic on this very large size? What is its characteristic?
You mean in these transitions or in the other? No, in the...
When you have this quantum, yeah, for example, this quantum size-driven transition, yes. What is the nature, really, of the transition?
The transition is driven by the size, and the size is discrete, so there is nothing...
So what do I see above this critical size? Is it periodic or above
You see the toric coat, if you want, a topologically ordered ground state with anionic excitations on top of it.
Yeah, but these excitations are on this immensely large size, that's what you're saying?
Yeah, of course, no, but they are localized, as in the toric coat. No, it's really what you get at the low energy is exactly a toric coat, if you want a topologically ordered system with anionic excitations, which are totally localized. So it's a switch. So what we managed to engineer is a switch. Somehow, if you want, I mean, it's very easy to understand. So imagine, so we have the energy levels, and then before the critical size, I mean, you look at, you want these energy levels. And above the critical size, what happens is that all these energy levels, only those, but not those, gain energy and keep gaining energy. So after the critical size, the ground state and first excited states are those. This is what happens.
About the extension.
Sorry?
My question is about the extension in space. What is the wave vector of this?
No, but unfortunately, maybe I don't understand the question, but the ground state after the transition is the standard toric code. The toric code, the Kitaev's toric code, maybe is really the ground state. Oh, okay. Indeed, you can decide which the one you prefer, but I mean, okay, it's just the toric code model is a model of a square lattice. No? Kitaev. In which somehow, which has is kind of the simplest model with topological order, no? Is in which you have plaquette and cross interactions, so the particles are in the links, and in each cross you have sigma c, sigma c, sigma c, sigma c, and in plaquette sigma x, sigma x, sigma x, sigma x, and then it's a commuting Hamiltonian, and then the ground state okay, can be seen to have topological order, and the first excited states have anionic statistics. They have, so the first, you can, the first excited states is just you take the ground state, and then you act, I mean, some spins, and then you create particles, or quasi-particles by pairs, and you can braid them, and then you obtain, but the excitations are totally localized in a plaquette or in a cross. I mean, they are not extensive or anything like that. I don't know if this answers your question. Since I don't know much physics, maybe I am not simply understanding the question. Sorry about it.
Okay, so maybe it's time to thank the speaker. Thanks.